In this video, I will show you how to derive an equation that can determine the theoretically optimal V size given material thickness, inside radius, and bend angle. With so many variables to consider, sheet metal air bending is sometimes considered an art. As this video will show, however, that is not usually the case. One key variable is die opening or V size. It affects the radius of the bend, which in turn affects the bend deduction, which in turn affects the accuracy of the flange lengths, and ultimately the quality of the finished part. For this reason, it is important to have a standardized method for V size selection. Many are guided by rules of thumb, tribal knowledge, or gut feelings. As we know, these can be dangerous in that they may produce inaccurate or, more importantly, varying results from operator to operator. Luckily, there is a way to determine the optimal V size given a few key parameters. So as I said, there are a number of rules of thumb out there which guide the selection of V die size. Common ones that I've heard are 6, 7, or 8 times material thickness. I've even heard all the way up to 10 or 12 times material thickness. So this right there tells us that these rules of thumb are open to guessing or variation or difference of opinion. Again, this is important because changing the V size directly affects the bend. It is one of the key variables, especially in airbending. Another issue is these rules of thumb do not work for radius bends, where the radius is greater than 1, maybe 2 times material thickness. For example, what if you need to use a 1/4 inch radius in 60 thousandths of an inch material? How would you determine the correct die opening to use? If you tried taking 8 times the material thickness, you would select a die opening around 0.48 inches. This would result in a very tight fit requiring a lot of tonnage, and the contact points would be very high in the die walls, where the die is weakest. Before I get into the mathematical solution, I want to give credit to Steve Benson's Fabricator article, where I learned this method, which I'll link up in the description, so check that article out. And check out anything else by Steve Benson. He is a sheet metal forming expert and puts out a lot of great information on these topics, so definitely go and check out his work as well. Alright, since rules of thumb don't always work, how do we determine the optimal V size? Well, the optimal V size would be when the outside setback of the bend is equal to half of the V wall. In other words, the tangent point of the outside radius is exactly at this halfway point in the die. This point is optimal for a few reasons. Without going into too much detail, if we think about the forces going into the bend, the smaller the die, the more forces required to bend the material, because the moment in the middle of the material decreases, making it harder to bend. If we go too big, in a sense, we are underutilizing the strength of the die and will end up using a die that's unnecessarily large for the required bend. Using this method also yields good bend geometry and helps avoid sharp or parabolic bend geometries caused by excessive force. And you can read about those types of bends or those phenomenon in Steve Benson's writing. Lastly, using this method standardizes the relationship between punch, die opening, and material thickness. This means that the K factors, theoretically, will remain more consistent between varying setups. So now that we know why this point is optimal, we can just use some basic trig to derive an equation that will give us the numbers we're looking for. As with many trig problems, there is more than one way to go about this, but I'll show you the way that I prefer. First, let's look at a simple 90 degree bend. The starting point and first triangle we will need to use to solve this problem looks like this, where we know the length of this leg is the inside radius plus the thickness. Then we can use this triangle to solve for this larger triangle whose hypotenuse is equal to the optimal V size opening or die opening. First, we should recognize that since this is a 90 degree bend, these are 45, 45, 90 triangles, meaning the two legs are equal. This means that both legs of this triangle are equal to the inside radius plus the thickness. Again, because these are 45, 45, 90 triangles, we can see that this leg is half the length of the larger leg. So the length of the larger triangle is 2 times the inside radius plus the thickness. Once we know this, it's just a matter of using the Pythagorean theorem to solve for the hypotenuse, which is again what we are after. So if we plug in our variables to the Pythagorean theorem and do a little bit of algebra, we get this simplified equation for solving for the optimal die opening size of a 90 degree bend. But what if the bend is not 90 degrees? Notice here we have an overbend. The cool thing about this method is that I have found it works very well for bends of any angle with the right math. Even with acute or obtuse bends, this method still works. And you may be thinking, if I wanted to overbend a piece of material to a 60 degree inside angle, I probably would use a 30 degree die to do it. And you're correct. Many overbend dies are 30 degrees, but this method still works because even though the die is 30 degrees, the material will be floated to whatever the desired bend angle is, since we are talking about airbending here. So it's almost like we can pretend the die would be the same as the bend angle. Kind of hard to explain, but I promise this method does work for bends of any angle. So with an acute or obtuse bend, we will still use the same halfway point on the die wall as a reference for the optimal die opening. The only difference is the trig is a little bit trickier since we aren't using a 45, 45, 90 triangle. I'll be using an acute angle bend to derive this equation, even though again, it works for bends of any angle. In order to solve for the V or die opening size, first let's start again with what we know. Starting with the smaller inside triangle, we know the short leg is equal to the inside radius plus the material thickness. We also know that one angle of this smaller inside triangle will be 1/2 the bend angle. With the larger triangle, we know W, the hypotenuse, will be twice the long leg of the inside triangle, and the short leg of this larger triangle will be 1/2 of V, the die opening size we're looking for. Once we know these things, we can just use some basic trig functions to solve for V. Going back to the mnemonic from high school, SOHCAHTOA, we can solve for W by setting the tangent of our triangle equal to the opposite over the adjacent leg. In our case, we would set the tangent of 1/2 the bend angle equal to the inside radius plus material thickness over 1/2 of W. With some algebra, this can be simplified to this equation, where we solve for W. Now that we have an equation for W, we want to solve for V by setting the sine of our angle equal to the opposite leg over the hypotenuse, which is W. In our case, we would set sine of 1/2 the bend angle equal to 1/2 of V, or the die opening, over W. Again, using some algebra magic, we can simplify this to a more easily digestible equation, and this would be the final equation we can use to solve for the optimal die opening, giving any combination of thickness, radius, and bend angle. So hopefully this gives you a good standardized method of die size opening selection. In the next video on this topic, I'll show you how to implement this in Excel and create a reference matrix sheet that can be distributed to the shop floor or whoever needs this information. Again, this is something that I use in practice. Since learning about this method, we have implemented it at my company and have seen pretty good results as long as this method is followed. I'm curious to hear how your company does things and if you think this is overkill. Is this something that should be standardized or should it be left up to operators to make these decisions? How could designers utilize this information to gain a better understanding of how their parts will be made? Let me know in the comments below. And if you're new to the Engineering Toolbox channel, be sure to subscribe so you can get all the content that I try to release every week. You'll find great ways to utilize Excel to solve engineering problems, free engineering software, and I also just started creating SOLIDWORKS sheet metal tutorials. So if that floats your boat, check it out. And as always, thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you next time.